really landmark educational platform for such a wide global audience. So let me hand it to you, Shelley, to take it away from here.
Thank you, Professor Verma. I'm so much looking forward to, at least it's morning here in Canada, this morning's event. And thank you to our global colleagues for joining us today. I know we are all very grateful to have the opportunity to hear from this group of heart failure and cardiology royalty. And now it is my distinct lifetime honor and pleasure to introduce to you Professor Eugene Braunwald. He is Distinguished Hersey Professor of Medicine at Harvard Medical School and the founding chair of the TIMI Study Group at Brigham and Women's Hospital. Professor Braunwald's first major paper was published in Circulation Research, July 1954. And his research has changed practice guidelines and affected the lives of millions. He was editor of Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine, a textbook I know we all have on our shelves, and Science Watch listed Dr. Braunwald as the most cited author in cardiology. He has an H index of 208 and growing. ACC and ESC have established annual lectures in his name, and Harvard University has established the Eugene Braunwald Endowed Chair in Medicine. Now join me in welcoming our keynote lecturer, Professor Eugene Braunwald, as we hear his personal reflections on the war against heart failure. Professor Braunwald, you may take the stage.
Thank you very much, Professor Theros. I am very pleased and honored to participate in this important session. I'm looking forward to learning a great deal. I'm going to give you a brief personal history of the treatment of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Next slide, please. I'm going to try to summarize 70 years of contacts that I've had with heart failure in 20 minutes. So it's a tough task. Next, please. These are my disclosures. Next slide, please. So we're going to follow this timeline. I begin with 1950, because in 1950, I was a third year medical student at New York University. And in my clerkship in internal medicine, I became acquainted with patients with heart failure. So for 70 years, I've had varying contacts in patients with heart failure, and I'm going to try to give you the highlights very rapidly. Next, please. So in 1952, which is when I actually graduated, what did we have available? Well, we had, of course, bed rest, low salt diet. We had two kinds of drugs, digitalis and diuretics. Diuretics were mercurial. They were given by painful intramuscular injection. They had to come either to a physician's office or the hospital to receive that. Next slide, please. Now, the first major change that occurred during the 70-year experience I had with heart failure came in 1960. When the thiazides, chlorothiazide, was introduced by Merck. And it made an enormous difference, because this was an orally active diuretic. And it had perhaps as big a change in the care of patients with heart failure as we've seen since. Next, please. That was followed about 7 years later by the development furosemide and then other loop diuretics, which obviously changed the care of patients with acute pulmonary edema and patients who are refractory to thiazides. This is in 1967. Next, please. Now, an important event occurred in 1967. Cardiac transplantation was described by Christian Barnard in South Africa. It attracted the attention of the world, and it was a headline above the fold in all of the world's newspapers. And of course, it did make a big difference, but only for a relatively small number of patients. And it took about 10 years until cardiac transplantation was something that we were able to count on. A lot of that came from the work of Norman Chambwe and his colleagues at Stanford. But we're still talking worldwide about 3,500 patients a year, the millions of patients with congestive heart failure. Next slide, please. In the middle 1970s, Jay Cohn had moved from Washington, D.C. to the University of Minnesota, and he introduced the concept of vasodilators, showed the effects of hydralazine and nitrates, and showed that in patients with heart failure, reduced ejection fraction, vasodilators improved survival. Very exciting series of studies. Next slide, please. This was followed about 6 years later by the introduction of ACE inhibitors, 1981, and they largely took the place of the vasodilators, although there still is room for vasodilators in a small group of patients, rather in the United States, mostly African Americans, who don't sometimes respond to ACE inhibition. So now we're in 1981. Next slide, please. 1990, the introduction of beta blockers for heart failure. Dr. Packer, of course, led the field with very, very important trials in beta blockade. Now, in 1990, we have ACE inhibitors, we have potent diuretics and beta blockers. And so the survival of patients has improved. Next, please. Also in 1990, we have next slide, please. In approximately 2000, left ventricular assist devices became more widely used after the REMATCH trial, which was led by Eric Rose, at that time at Columbia University, which showed that in patients with very far advanced heart failure who were not otherwise surgical candidates, optimal medical therapy, life was prolonged by in this randomized trial, life was prolonged by chronic left ventricular assist devices. Next slide, please. In the early years of this century, use of devices came along, ICDs, implanted cardioverter defibrillators, and CRC for stimulating the failing left ventricle early in this century. Next slide, please. MRA, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists, very important trial. The drugs had really been around since the 1960s. They were developed by a pharmaceutical company actually at the same time that the thiazides were, but it really took a major trial to show that life was sufficiently prolonged in patients who were receiving excellent therapy with most of these other drugs. Next slide, please. And now we come to very modern times. We have the sacubitril valsartan, the ARNI, and that should be shown as 2014. And we have on this program the two leaders of this, Dr. McMurray and Dr. Packer, a very huge advance. And the next slide, please. And then also looking, the slide has become distorted, but we wanted to show this at 200, at 2016, not 2010, the development of SGLT2 inhibitors. So there have been an enormous number of advances in the treatment of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And it's certainly been a privilege for me to have the opportunity to have watched all of these come along and every once in a while stick my oar into the water. Next slide, please. Well, where do we go from here? That's a big question. Can I have the next slide? So I go to a famous Chinese philosopher, Confucius, 500 years BC. And Confucius says, it is dangerous to predict. Next slide, please. Next. Especially about the future. So we don't quite really know where this is going. I think that there obviously are several challenges. First, there is a major trial that is going to be presented shortly, and that is a new inotrope of myosin activator. None of us know how that trial, what that trial is going to show, but it will be an important story. I think that the problem of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is one that we have not made as much progress on. And I think that that's related to the fact that we're dealing with multiple diseases that have some similarities about phenotype. And I think we have to begin to divide those. I feel that heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is very, we're at a stage that we were with anemia 100 years ago. And we didn't know that there was iron deficiency anemia, pernicious anemia, anemia of blood loss, anemia secondary to invasion of the bone marrow. And I think obviously we can't treat all patients with anemia the same. And I think the same story is likely to help us with heart failure and preserved ejection fraction. I can't wait to hear John's discussion, because in looking at these 15 developments that I had on the timeline, obviously we don't give all 15 to the majority of our patients. So we have to figure out which ones we can get rid of and what the sequence should be. So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to talk about the 70 years in heart failure.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Professor Braunwald, for your really inspiring presentation, outlining the history of our developments, and your final comments were very telling about where the field is moving with respect to our maybe really sort of a rudimentary understanding of HFpEF, and how we really need to start thinking more about phenotypes and different types of diseases within HFpEF to be targeting that disease more appropriately. It's now my great pleasure to introduce a colleague and a friend, Professor John McMurray, who will give us the next presentation entitled Comprehensive Integration of Heart Failure Therapies from Vertical to Horizontal Integration Models. I think many of you know Professor McMurray and have heard him speak before. Let me briefly introduce him. He's a professor of medical cardiology, deputy director, Institute of Cardiovascular and Medical Sciences at the University of Glasgow. He's also honorary consultant cardiologist at Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow. Professor McMurray has led or been part of many of the heart failure guidelines globally. He has led or co-led many of the important trials in the area of heart failure and reduced ejection fraction. I'm always concerned that if I introduce him appropriately, he actually does not like it. He wants his introductions to be quite brief. As you know, he recently received, don't cut me off, guys, go back to the last slide. He recently received the ESC gold medal just this year, and we're extremely proud of that accomplishment, John, on your behalf. And he's published over, I think, 1,000 publications and has a H index of close to 200 already. I think all of those scientific attributes put aside, let me just tell you on a personal note, he's a wonderful human being with tremendous integrity and gravitas, very inclusive. I had the pleasure of working with him on the DAPA-HF trial. And science aside, I think the human aspect of John, I think, is something that requires a great deal of recognition, because that is often sometimes that is not a combination that we see in academics. So I couldn't think of anybody else better than to give this difficult topic, and that is, how do you actually synthesize these various therapies? And can we go from, can we challenge the dogma or the current algorithm of sort of a linear sequential pattern of integrating these therapies into something that is more horizontal? Welcome, John, and thank you for doing this.
Thank you, Subbu. That was a longer introduction than my talk actually is. I could see Milton laughing when you were saying what a wonderful human being I was. Anyway, I'm delighted to be here. I can think of very few things worse than having to follow Professor Braunwald. And in fact, it was interesting listening to his presentation. I was born around the time that Fazad diuretics were introduced, and I graduated after the introduction of ACE inhibitors, and I've obviously learned from people like him and from Milton, so I'm a sort of relative beginner in all of this. And thank you also, Subbu, for this wonderful title. I wasn't even sure what it meant, and I'm not sure I'm going to be able to answer the question it asks, but I'll give it a go. So hopefully I'll also get my slides to advance. No, okay, here we go. So these are my disclosures. So this is a word actually I've borrowed from you, Subbu, which is foundational. And this is really what you heard from Professor Braunwald, where we were at really at the beginning of this century, certainly the end of the first decade of this century, where I think there was common agreement that these three types of drugs should be used together with the core therapies for the management of patients with heart failure and reduced ejection fraction. And that was because, used together, we'd seen in multiple trials, and that's very important, we had a strong evidence base. In multiple trials, we saw this stepwise reduction in mortality. We believed that these drugs worked independently, were complementary, their effects were additive, and every guideline in the world said, if you've got a patient with HFrEF, they should be getting these three treatments. Although I have to say, even today, sadly, a lot of people don't get mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists. So this is my equivalent of Professor Braunwald's timeline, but I've started mine more recently, and this is from the beginning of this century, and it's really the first part of that. And I've highlighted here the trial at Milton and I led, looking at neprilysin inhibition, which was really, until very recently, the next big breakthrough in terms of pharmacological therapy after those three core treatments that I mentioned. And of course, that was in the PARADIGM heart failure trial. And again, sometimes this trial is a little bit confusing, I think. It was about neprilysin inhibition. The valsartan part of it was not so relevant. This was really testing the incremental benefit of inhibiting this enzyme that we know breaks down natriuretic peptides, but actually, as the years go by, we learn that it's got many other substrates. And in fact, for all we know, some of those may be important as well in the action of neprilysin inhibition. But what we did show clearly in PARADIGM heart failure is that adding a neprilysin inhibitor on top of those core background treatments, and of course, in addition to diuretic and in some patients, digoxin, we saw this 20% relative risk reduction in the primary composite outcome, cardiovascular death or heart failure hospitalization, and actually proportionally an identical risk reduction in each of the two components of that endpoint, and indeed a reduction in overall mortality. So really in the past 5 years, the guideline committees, I believe, have gradually come round to considering now sucubitril valsartan as foundational therapy, remembering, of course, that that pill contains two pharmacologically active agents. And until last year, probably we would have said the current modern foundational pharmacological treatment of the patient with heart failure and reduced ejection fraction should be these three pills, these four pharmacological approaches to improving survival and also, of course, reducing morbidity and improving symptoms. But things have been moving very fast. And last year at the European Society of Cardiology, we presented DAPHF. You heard Professor Brownwell mention SGLT2 inhibitors, and DAPHF indeed was a trial using one of these agents, which were originally introduced as a treatment for diabetes. They lower blood glucose by inhibiting reabsorption of filtered glucose in the proximal renal tubule, increase urinary glucose excretion, and with that, by the way, water and sodium, and for that reason were regarded as a new anti-hyperglycemic therapy. But for a number of reasons, we thought these drugs might also be beneficial in patients with heart failure. And we conducted the DAPHF trial. You can see here that this was a trial in typical HFrEF patients. They didn't all have diabetes. More than half did not have type 2 diabetes. They were pretty well treated with our foundational therapies, although sadly not with sucubitril valsartan quite as much as we would have liked. Come back to that in a moment. And as you can see here, adding an SGLT2 inhibitor to an ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, an MRA, diuretics, digoxin, further reduced morbidity and mortality. And in fact, no matter what hospitalization or what mortality endpoint we looked at, there was a consistent and significant reduction in these. And of course, the key question, because a lot of cardiologists still thought, oh, these are just drugs for diabetes, maybe they're only working in patients who had diabetes. Key question was, do they work in HFrEF patients who don't have diabetes? And the answer, as you can see in this figure, is very clearly yes, they do. And as we'll hear in a moment, that was confirmed in the EMPEROR Reduced trial, a second study in HFrEF patients using a different SGLT2 inhibitor. So it was great to see earlier this year in the US and then more recently in Canada and now in many countries around the world, we have repurposed SGLT2 inhibitors so that they're no longer just a treatment for type 2 diabetes, but they've got a second new indication, which is for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, irrespective of diabetes status. And the good news is from this trial and from EMPEROR Reduced is that these are remarkably well tolerated drugs. And that, of course, is critical to when we come down to that question that Professor Brownwell raised about, can we use all of these treatments together? We really saw no significant excess of any adverse event, and in particular ones that we had originally been worried about, volume depletion, meaning things like hypotension, dehydration, and so on. So now we have, in 2019, two trials, both showing these very impressive reductions in morbidity and mortality. And of course, the question that we all had last summer was, are these treatment benefits additive? Are we convinced of that? Can we use these drugs safely together? Will patients tolerate both sacubitril valsartan and an SGLT2 inhibitor? So that takes us to this year, and what's happened this year, there are two new trials that have reported, but I won't address the Victoria trial. But of course, we've seen the results of Emperor Reduced, led by Milton Packer, whose name has come up a few times in terms of breakthroughs in heart failure therapeutics. And here are the results of Emperor Reduced, side by side with the results of DAPHF, same, looking at this treatment effect and the same endpoints. And if we look at the primary composite outcome in Emperor Reduced, which is was our secondary and first secondary endpoint, you can see here you could not had a closer result. Hazard ratio for both trials 0.75, 25% relative risk reduction, very large reduction in both first and recurrent heart failure hospitalizations. So in 2020 going forward, we have a lot of choices. I have focused on SGLT2 inhibitors and neprilysin inhibitors, but in fact, we've added four different novel pharmacological therapies to these three foundational drugs. But I'm focusing on neprilysin inhibition and SGLT2 inhibition because these are life-saving treatments. These improve survival, and I think that will always mean that there is a priority to use these drugs. I'm not saying vericiguat or ivabradine are not important. They are. They're valuable additional therapies to have for our patients with HFrEF, but drugs that reduce mortality, I think, are more important. So in 2020, we've got what you might call the five alive. In fact, I heard this on a this term used on a Canadian webinar, and we have five drugs acting through different pathophysiological pathways. That's a critically important concept, I think, for going forward. They have different mechanisms of action. We believe these are complementary and additive, and I'll come back to that in a moment, because clearly that's the key question about the most recent two members of this rather exclusive club. And it's also important to realize that these five pharmacological approaches can be given in four different pills, because of course sacubitril valsartan contains two of those, and that may be a pointer to the way ahead as well. I cannot imagine, for example, why it wouldn't make sense perhaps to combine an MRA and an SGLT2 inhibitor in a single pill. So are we justified in using all five? Can we use all five? Are we convinced that that's worthwhile? Do we believe our patients can tolerate these? And really, the question focuses in the most recent two of these developments. We'd already learned to use RAS blockers, beta blockers, and MRAs. The question is now, can we add two more treatments? Do we need to add two more treatments? Will our patients tolerate them? So last summer, I showed this subgroup interaction figure. I think I remember you saying to me, Milton, it was a mistake to show this. And you were right, because I think it's been very misunderstood. And I should probably have shown it like this, because, of course, to understand subgroup interactions, you really have to look at the consistency of the effect of therapy in the subgroup compared to the overall patient population. The line of unity, which we normally concentrate on so much when we look at figures like this, it's not relevant here. What is relevant is the p-value for interaction. And as you can see here, that was non-significant. In other words, that tells me that background sacubitril valsartan therapy did not modify the benefit of an SGLT2 inhibitor. In other words, you were getting the same additional benefit when you added an SGLT2 inhibitor, even in people who were already hopefully benefiting from sacubitril valsartan. And then Milton 2 weeks ago showed us in the EMPEROR reduced trial where they had a much larger proportion of patients, 19% patients on sacubitril valsartan treatment at baseline. Again, you can see no evidence of an interaction. In fact, you can remarkably see here within subgroup significance for the effect of empagliflozin on the primary endpoint. So no question at all that these two treatments together are additively beneficial. And in fact, if you do the arithmetic, if you combine the benefit in paradigm heart failure with the benefit, for example, we saw in DAPHF, you're now talking about, with just two new pills, remarkable additional benefits. For example, for this composite of cardiovascular death or heart failure hospitalization, a further 40% reduction over and above standard therapy. So what about tolerability? So that's the other question, obviously, most people ask. And in many ways, I think that's what stops many doctors who look after patients with heart failure using many of our treatments, is perceived intolerance. Well, we have published in detail our experience in DAPHF of adding dapagliflozin on top of sacubitril valsartan. You can see here tiny changes in blood pressure, tiny changes in creatinine, tiny changes in potassium. And these very small changes were not different in the patients taking sacubitril valsartan at baseline compared to those not. So when you add an SGLT2 inhibitor on top of sacubitril valsartan, you do not see typically significant hypotension or renal dysfunction or potassium disturbances. And in fact, if you look at adverse events, if you look at treatment discontinuation, you see here no difference between an SGLT2 inhibitor and placebo when you add the SGLT2 inhibitor on top of sacubitril valsartan. So the evidence is that these treatments combined are more efficacious, and the evidence is that when you use these treatments together, you can do that safely. In general, they're tolerated well together. And as you can see here, few patients actually have to discontinue these treatments. So there is a strong reason to use these treatments together. And we have two trials, remember. So I said that we need to be convinced that it's worth using these two new treatments in combination, increasing our patients from three to five therapies. Well, we have the justification to do that. We've now got two positive trials, and I've showed you the evidence of excellent tolerability. So I can already hear probably people going, oh, too many treatments, it's too hard. Can we use all these together? It's too expensive, whatever. But we don't say this when we talk about other disease areas. We don't even say this in cardiology. We routinely give people who have a PCI, a primary PCI for their acute myocardial infarction, two antiplatelet drugs, a statin, a beta blocker, and an ACE inhibitor. It's very usual to use treatments in combination when their benefits are additive and when they're tolerated, taken together. So sometimes I wonder if we're making excuses for finding it difficult to do this. So how do we do it? And this gets to the question of vertical horizontal integration. So this is the ESC guideline from 2016, but most guidelines around the world look like this. And the question is today, do we need to move away from this approach? I would suggest we probably do if the algorithm is going to fit onto one page, because clearly we've got more treatments. In fact, I'll let you into a little secret here, but you may have noticed at the top, ACE inhibitors and beta blockers are now in the same line. In the previous guidelines, they weren't. You were supposed to use an ACE inhibitor first, titrate to maximum dose, then add a beta blocker, but this algorithm would no longer fit in the page, so it had to be compressed. So suddenly it was possible to use two treatments together, and there's maybe a lesson there. And I'm a great guideline believer, but I no longer believe that this vertical stepwise approach is the right one. I think this idea that you have to titrate everybody to full dose of each drug before moving on to the next doesn't make sense. And using these therapies in a chronological order that reflects the order in which the clinical trials were done does not make sense either. Now, why do I say that? Well, firstly, I say that because while it is important to get to full dose of the treatments, to use the target doses used in the trial, you get most of the benefit with a modest dose of drug. And Milton will remember the ATLAS trial very well. And of course, more recently, we've got the HEAL trial. Remarkably, in cardiology and in heart failure, we have so many trials. These are trials comparing a small dose of a RAS blocker to a big dose of a RAS blocker. Where is the incremental benefit? It's in a further modest reduction in heart failure hospitalization. It's not in reducing mortality. So it perhaps makes more sense to add a second drug acting in a different way, a complementary way, than necessarily titrating to the full dose of the first drug and wasting time. And time is important. And if you think about our standard therapy, beta blockers and RAS blockers, and now Sacubitril and Valsartan, it can take up to 16 weeks to titrate somebody to a full dose of treatment. If you're going to wait 16 weeks before you add the second drug, then I'm afraid a lot of people are going to suffer. Because what I didn't mention earlier, but what is a fact, is that with both of these new treatments, we saw a significant benefit within 30 days, in less than 30 days of randomization, in less than 1 month after starting treatment. Think about those 16 weeks, think about those 4 months. How many people might die if we're going to wait to add the other treatments? So to me, it doesn't make sense. We have to think about ease of titration. We have to think about complementary pathophysiological mechanisms, additive, and the importance trying to get as many of these treatments started as soon as possible. And I've always wondered why we, our country, our government has legal guidance for timeframes in which people have to be referred and treated for cancer, but we don't have that same sense of urgency, I think, when we treat patients with heart failure, but we should, and we have treatments that work incredibly quickly. So this is the way I think we have to think about it. We've got to think about it in a horizontal or non-vertical way. In addition to ease of use and timeliness treatments, and they even thought some of these things yourself, those treatments already, they even so these have been amazing times. I think you'll agree, we've made great breakthroughs. We've got fantastic evidence. You could not have a better evidence base. The problem is implementation, and we need to use these treatments, and our patients need them, and they need them now. Thank you very much.
Well, wonderful, Professor McMurray. Just a treat to hear you speak. And